Hey, I want to thank you for joining us tonight. It's a very special home host evening. And as you can see, we've just gathered together in this serene setting. And we've got the fireplace going. It's a little warm and toasty in here.
Chestnuts are roasting over the open fire.
Yes, it's just a beautiful environment for
Jack Frost is nipping at my nose.
Yes, yes, he is. At 72 degrees, that Jack Frost. It's a Las Vegas Jack Frost, I guess. But we want to thank you for being part of our home host night. This is going to be the last one of our entire year. And I've just really been encouraged by what God's done through this ministry. How about you?
Oh, I am so thankful we've had this. It was in November of last year that Pastor Matt said, hey, why don't we establish a new ministry and call it Prayer Groups? And we really did not realize how important they were going to be with the COVID coming up, that we were gonna, what some things that are absolutely essential for for the church would be absent. But we've been able to do those things. You know, the Bible says the early church met together for prayer, for fellowship, for the breaking of bread, and for the teaching of the apostles' doctrine. We could teach the word of God over the internet, but you can't have fellowship, and you can't have prayer, and you can't have accountability.
It's so true.
Over the internet, we needed that prayer group, and we had the first prayer group at the end of at the end of February, and so we were able to get this happening.
And this is our fourth one of the year, and I want to thank you as a prayer group leader for opening up your home and allowing folks to assemble together. And if you are part of a prayer group, I know it's a funny time, but I commend your courage and your desire to be part of God's church. There were three reasons why we started prayer groups. We wanted people to pray. That's a very important thing for people to pray. And then we also wanted people to fellowship, provide an environment where people could connect with each other. And then it's important that we all have accountability. And that is not unlike the very first Christmas.
Yeah, the very first Christmas, they were certainly meeting together. They were, you have Joseph and Mary. These two are accountable one to another. I mean, you're talking about accountability. Mary gets pregnant, she has to go and tell somebody that she's pregnant. And she has to tell Joseph, and Joseph is like, I can't believe this, my fiance has gone nuts. But an angel comes and says, listen, not only you need to understand this, what she said is true, and you are now accountable to God for raising his son. What an amazing thing.
Even Mary and Joseph needed accountability.
That's exactly right. So they're accountable one to another, and they're accountable to God.
The shepherds also provided accountability, didn't they?
Yes, they did. I mean, they came in, the angel said, you go see, and they went, and then they had to go, after they were finished, they went and announced to everybody.
See, the purpose of accountability is more than just gathering. There is a purpose, there's an agenda. As a church, we gather together for the purpose of knowing the Word of God and encouraging one another to do what God's will is in our lives. And that's not unlike. So Mary and Joseph, the shepherds, were accountable to each other, but there was fellowship there as well.
That's exactly right. These shepherds come at night, and they come they're fellowshipping with one another. They leave and they come together to meet with Joseph and Mary. And now can you imagine what that was like?
Well, there was nobody. They were in a foreign place. They were in an unsettled environment. They're in a farm, for crying out loud, in a stable. And here's some folks who are bringing, no doubt, some type of comfort. I would imagine that they were bringing some gifts or perhaps some food or provision for these weary travelers who just had a baby. So there was fellowship that was incumbent upon that first Christmas.
And then, of course, you've got the wise men from the east, the Magi, coming in, and they are coming to worship the Lord. And we don't know exactly how close of that was together, but they're there. They're there to worship the Lord. They're there to be an encouragement.
Yes.
We need that encouragement. We need to have fellowship.
Yeah, it's so important, especially at this season, where we are praying with each other, where we're accountable to each other, where we are fellowshipping with each other. That is the essence of God's church. And I said it a moment ago, but the need for prayer.
Oh, yes. I mean, the whole Christmas story starts off in Luke chapter 1. You've got Zacharias there, and he's praying. And what is he praying for? He's praying for deliverance for Israel.
Sure.
He's praying for those things. And the angel comes along and says, you're going to get your prayers answered.
Yeah.
And says, John the Baptist is going to be born, and comes to Mary and says, Mary, again, an answer to prayer, hundreds of years of prayer. God is going to send the Savior. Mm-hmm. It all starts with prayer. Everything in the Christian life starts with prayer. And the Bible says that we're to pray one for another,
yes,
that we might be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much.
He says, pray without ceasing.
Yeah. In Luke chapter 18, he says, men ought always to pray and not to,
yes,
faint. We need to keep on praying. And we need that prayer one with another. I need to hear you pray for me. I need to hear others. I need to pray for others in their presence, because there's something very comforting, and it's not just the comfort. Prayer, God answers prayer.
Powerful.
But there's something that just eases my spirit when somebody is praying for me about something that I'm going through.
And the Bible says, "Where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst." So the idea of corporate or public prayer is so important. And really, that's the purpose of this evening. We want to just encourage you that what we're doing tonight is not just an exercise where we celebrate or we hand out gifts or we might have some food together because it's a tradition. It truly is the essence of what the church is about. A church is supposed to be a place of prayer, both private but public, corporate prayer, where we're encouraging each other, where we're accountable one to another, because I need you and you need me. And not only that, we fellowship. My dearest friends are part of the church.
Yeah, that's exactly right, and that's the way it should be. Our dearest friends are in the church. That God says that he put the church together. It's like the very first support group. We talk about support groups in our culture today. The very first support group was God saying, it's not good for you to be by yourself. You need someone. And I think it's interesting too, throughout the scripture, we have God ordaining times of feasting,
mm-hmm,
times of where
celebrations.
Well, yeah, we were talking about the fact that Solomon, weeks they got together celebrating the establishment of the temple. And what were some of those other ones?
Well, it's interesting, as we wrap this up, when we celebrate Christmas, it's a time when we celebrate Emmanuel, God being with us.
Oh, that's true.
And that's all throughout the Bible.
And that's fellowship.
Yes, when David brought the Ark of the Covenant into the tabernacle in Jerusalem, he brings it in. Why? Because it was a picture of God being with us. Whenever Solomon dedicated the temple, they brought the glory of the Lord shone on that temple. And there was a magnificent celebration. Why? Because God was with us. We celebrate this season as Bible-believing Christians because it was not just a foretelling, it wasn't just a picture. God came to this earth, and he had a purpose for that. He came to live a perfect life, to die on a cross for our sins, to be buried, and then 3 days later rise from the dead, proving that he was God and everything he said was true. And that's the responsibility we have, and I want to encourage you tonight to pray. There's so many things to pray for. But pray for one another, pray for our country, pray for us as a church, that God would use us to do great things by faith in this next year. Allow us to be accountable to each other. Encourage one another in a season where fear is all over the place. Encourage one another to be courageous in our Lord. And not only that, let's fellowship with each other. I hope that tonight you'll have a time of drinking coffee or eating cookies or whatever else you've got planned. I hope tonight is a time a fellowship for you, because that's what prayer groups are all about. And I'm so thrilled that you're part of our prayer group meeting tonight. Pastor, anything that you'd like to add before we close?
I hope that you are having a Merry Christmas. I hope that tonight will be part of the Christmas celebration. The word Christmas means the coming forth of Christ. Let's do, as Pastor Matt said, let's fellowship, let's encourage one another, let's be accountable to one another, and let's go out as the shepherds did and tell everybody when you leave this place tonight, have it in your heart to go out and tell other people about Jesus Christ. Pray for one another that we might be the witnesses God wants us to be during this time of Christmas. Christmas, and let's just share the truth of the gospel with everyone. And so, let's say it together. Let's say Merry Christmas together, okay?
Merry Christmas. I hope that you'll take a great evening off and enjoy each other. Your prayer group leader has several announcements about things coming up in the next few weeks.
Wow, some exciting things, too.
Some exciting things, and I hope that you'll be part of them. We'll see you next Sunday night here on campus as we wish each other a Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
God bless.